see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Welcome to the It's in Queens podcast, the only podcast that focuses on the borough of Queens. Each week I talk with the people of Queens, or I focus on places in Queens that make the borough so special. While the temperatures dropped significantly this weekend, I decided to get out and walk around and savor the sights and sounds of the borough. I was able to recently meet with some friends at the Cheesecake Factory at the Queens Center Mall, and it's only a few miles from my home. I decided to walk both to and from the mall through Elmhurst and Corona so I could do some exploring. I feel like every time I walk around, I discover something new, a historic site or a landmark building, a mom-and-pop immigrant-run shop, or a new restaurant that I can add to my must-visit list. Now, don't get me wrong, as much as I love walking around, in winter weather, I'd prefer to take mass transit as much as I could to get around, to save time, but really, to avoid the cold. But amid the pandemic, I didn't take the 7F or E as much as I used to, but now that's picking up once again as we continue to emerge from this pandemic. I've been in New York City for more than 2.5 decades now. Actually, it's getting close to 3 decades. Mass transit always helps me get to my destinations for work or for pleasure a lot more quickly and without the hassle of having to find parking in some neighborhoods. But I recognize it can take considerable time to get some places because the way our subway systems operate, and that they don't always reach many areas, requiring a subway to a bus and then a long walk. While I live in Queens, I've been able to take most of the subway lines, and for instance, it can take a good amount of time for me to get from my home in Jackson Heights to the Rockaways if I'm using the subway system. I mean, this takes beyond an hour and a half, sometimes close to 2 hours, and I have to go through Manhattan. But there is a plan out there that could substantially change that. It's called QueensLink, and that looks to create a new north-south transit link in Queens while using available land for new park space. The QueensLink proposes rerouting the M train and creating 3.5 miles of an extension. I wanted to learn more about this plan and where it stands, so this week I talked with Paul Trust, who serves as a community liaison for QueensLink. Paul's a musician, an educator, a political activist, and a mass transit advocate, and he joined QueensLink during the summer of 2021. As a community liaison, he connects with elected officials, local groups, organizations, neighborhood activists, and businesses so he can talk about QueensLink and answer any of their questions or concerns. Here's that interview. Paul Trust, welcome to the It's in Queens podcast.
Thank you so much, Jeff. Really happy to be here.
So, QueensLink, what exactly is this? What should folks know?
All right. So, QueensLink is the proposal to reactivate the Rockaway line, which has been out of commission since the early 1960s. And this isn't the first proposal to suggest reactivation, but ours is the first one that wants to do it as an M train extension going from Rego Park down to the Rockaways, and also include up to 33 acres of park and trail space alongside and underneath the tracks where possible.
You know, how will this work? How will something like this take place?
That's a very good question. Well, so one thing that QueensLink, our particular company has only been around for about 5 years. And what we were waiting on was an MTA feasibility study, as in, can this actually be done? Can an M train, like a subway, can this be reactivated as a subway line? And once that was that they came out with their study and showed that, yes, this can be done, then that sort of got the ball rolling for us. What we noticed with the study, though, is that they put a price tag on it that was very, very high. It was a little over $8 billion. And we were like, that's one of the most expensive transit projects in the world at that point. So what we did is we spoke to some of our lawmaker friends, such as Bob Holden and Donovan Richards when he was a city councilman, and also Stacey Amato. And we got together some discretionary funding to do our own independent study using a company called Thames that had worked on like the rail line in Washington, D.C. And they did a study and gave us the results. I think we got it over the summer. And it showed using government algorithms that are accepted algorithms for costs and analysis, their costs came in significantly lower at around $3.2 billion. So that that showed, you know, a greater degree of feasibility than what the MTA showed. So how can this happen? Well, that's, you know, there's a few ways to possibly fund a project like this, but ultimately it would have to go through the MTA. So what we're really working on is, instead of like a top-down approach, we're trying to do a bottom-up approach and building community support, and also just letting people know who we are and what we're trying to do, such as, you know, my being on your show, Jeff. And, you know, that way when we feel if the community boards, the block associations, the different organizations and lawmakers along the line have enough interest and want this to happen, then we can, you know, go back to the MTA and see if we can make this a reality.
So walk me through some of the communities. I'd love for people who are listening to know, oh, this would be through my community. This is going to give me more transit access as well.
Sure. So with a reactivation, our proposal is an M train. So the M train right now ends at 71st Continental and Forest Hills. So this would, and this is the interesting thing, is that when they designed the Queens Boulevard line, they saw this as a possibility. So this is going back to the 1930s. They actually created what's called a Bellmouth portal. So they put a portal, like a tunnel, like if this ever happens, we're going to set them up for it to make it easy to happen. So there is this portal that's just been sitting there for, you know, 90 years, waiting to be connected to this line. Because when the train went out, when the Long Island Railroad Rockaway branch went out of commission, they sold it to the city, assuming that it would get turned into a subway. So we're not a new proposal. We're just like the latest incarnation of trying to make this happen. And so it would go from 63rd by the IKEA over there on Queens Boulevard. So then it would shoot down. The next stop would be Metropolitan Avenue, which is a transit desert as well. The northern part of Forest Hills has a lot of train access by Queens Boulevard, but not so much by Metropolitan Avenue. So we're looking at this as a way to take that business district and provide them with more access. Also, there's Metropolitan High School over there, so greater access for students to get to their school. Then it would go down to around Jamaica Avenue, which is like two blocks south of Forest Park. Also a business district that's right on the border of Woodhaven and Richmond Hill. So this would provide that business district, which could really use a nice boost, some greater access. Then it would go down, the next stop, I believe, is Liberty Avenue, which is also known as Little Guyana. And Little Guyana is a wonderful community, a great foodie neighborhood, much sought after for its doubles and roti. However, it is very hard to get to. So for someone who lives in, say, Jackson Heights that loves a lot of ethnic cuisine, there really isn't a great way to get to Little Guyana to experiment and try the different wonderful foods and that business district as well, what it has to offer. So there would be a stop at Liberty Avenue. Then it would also continue down. And this is where... So the Rockaway branch, as I said, was deactivated, and part of it has been reactivated. It's the A train where it goes down and it goes and splits off to the Rockaway. So it's already been partially reactivated. So the M train would continue to Resorts World Aqueduct, which is the same line that the A train runs. So it would continue down. And, you know, one thing that we've recently heard about, thanks to some lawmakers pushing this, including Adrian Adams, that they're looking to expand the gaming license for Resorts World to make it into a full-fledged casino. So if Resorts World, you know, at the level of like Foxwoods or Mohegan Sun. So if that happens, the M train will be there for those who want to come from Midtown to Western Queens to Central Queens, be able to access Resorts World Aqueduct Complex easily. And that's also an air train stop over there. And then it would continue down into the Rockaways. Which direction it goes, because the Rockaways kind of split east or west, that is sort of our plan is deliberately loose, because we are looking for the community input. So we want to know where people want it to go. Once it's on the A train line, it can go either way.
How did you get involved in this and why?
Okay, good question. So, Jeff, I lived in Jackson Heights up until August of this year. And one of the reasons I lived in Jackson Heights for about 15 years. And one of the reasons I chose Jackson Heights is because of the transit. I do not have a car. And I rely on mass transit to get around to and from, work and also visiting friends. And I'm also a musician. So to go to different shows that I might be performing in or supporting others. And then I moved to Richmond Hill, Queens. And one reason we moved to where we are is we're very close to the J train, but I quickly learned the J train is not the E or the F express. It is a slow moving rickety train. There's one stop called Crescent Street that literally takes about 5 minutes to get to curve around the bends to get around. So I learned that, yes, I'm near a train, but let's also say this, that the past 3 weekends, I think it's been out because of construction. So my options are very limited. I learned very quickly, Southern Queens is a transit desert. Queens has grown, I believe, the most in population. Over the past 10 years, the census shows it's grown about the equivalent of Salt Lake City in population, just Queensboro alone. And most people who live in Queens, work in Queens, they're not going to the city. And most of our train lines are geared towards Manhattan. And I just realized that there just wasn't a great way to get around. There's a couple north-south buses, but they're unreliable at best. I have a screenshot on my phone that says the next Q37 is coming in an hour and 37 minutes. And I thought, let me take a shot of that. So people kind of can, if they're just in case they're wondering, can buses substitute for a reliable train line? No, it can't. They both should be working in tandem. So I realized that Southern Queens, could use, there's a lot of communities that have are transit deserts, and I think it could benefit. And I discovered QueensLink just from researching about different projects and things that are going on in the neighborhood. And I just reached out to them on Twitter and I just said, how can I help? I just happened to know a lot of lawmakers and what have you, just being in Jackson Heights and being active in the politically in the community. And so I was like, and they wrote me back and said, let's meet up. And so we met up at a diner right below the train tracks and they said, let's have you on board. So what I've been doing is just kind of spreading, like, I guess I'm a hype man in a way. Like, I'm just trying to promote the line and see if we can help build support and reaching out to different lawmakers and organizations and community boards.
And I should also note, this isn't just about transit, but possibly parks as well. I'd love for you to talk about that, but the impact that this could have on creating more parks.
Sure. So one of the reasons QueensLink came about is that there was a town hall between QueensLink and I think at the time it was called Queens Rail. And there was a proposal, there's also a proposal, competing proposal called Queens Way, which is the idea of taking the line, and it would not be reactivated, but would be turned into a linear park running from the start of it up by Queens Boulevard all the way down to where the A train is that's been activated. From what I had heard, this is before I got on the team, is that Donovan Richards basically heard both sides and said, you two work it out. There's got to be a way we can do both. And so that's kind of where this proposal came about, is that if you look at a lot of other cities, there have been newer train lines that have been built sort of like the AirTrain that is sort of like on columns and alongside and underneath the tracks, they have... you can see some have even like football fields or soccer fields and spaces for bikes to go north and south. So we looked at the concepts that are done in other cities. And one of the thing about New York is we don't really have any new train lines. We have the Second Avenue, but that's underground. We haven't really built anything above ground in a long time. So except for the AirTrain, right? So, there's been a lot that has been done around the world that we would like to incorporate as a modern train system here in New York City. So by Forest Hills down to Forest Park, it is very wide. There's a lot that can be done. Then it gets very narrow by Woodhaven. And so we actually just recently engaged in dialogue with TransAlt transportation alternatives. And, you know, we'd like to work with them, see if maybe if it's too narrow for a bike path, maybe we can do something with Woodhaven Boulevard, which would certainly use a redo to see if it's possible to create a bike path. So we're looking to work with other organizations to see what can be done to have both rail and other means of transportation like bikes.
Who are some of your main supporters of this?
So some of our main supporters, as I mentioned, Bob Holden and Stacey Amato have been our biggest champions. We just had a conversation with the new city councilwoman for District 32, Joanne Areola, and she's looking to help us as well and put aside hopefully some funding so we can propel this forward. Jennifer Rajkumar has also offered her support. So we're looking forward to working with her. I just tweeted her today that we know we're due for another conversation. So we're slowly but surely building up support in Southern Queens, which has the most to gain being the transit desert. We're looking forward to meeting with lawmakers and groups in the Forest Hills Rego Park area to, you know, sort of gauge their temperature and work with them as well.
And, you know, Paul, I do not hold it against you if you moved out of Jackson Heights. You know, I figured I could still interview you for this podcast, but what do you miss the most about Jackson Heights?
Oh, wow. I miss the transit. That's an obvious. Honestly, I love Jackson Heights. I lived there for 15 years. You know what I miss most? I think if someone was to ask me, you know, that question from the neighborhood, which you are, Jeff, we were neighbors. I miss, you know, some used to refer to me a bit as like the mayor of Jackson Heights. I used to say to my wife, like when we walk down 37th Avenue, it's a lot of like slow hand waves. Hi, how you doing? Oh, great to see you. All right, see you on Saturday. How you doing? Going to Traverse? Okay, we'll be there in a little bit. Like I kind of miss that sense of tight-knit community of just knowing so many people and just the familiarity of what I feel is a really solid neighborhood of different ethnicities and just different, you know, people who've come to this place that's very compact and very populated. It seems like for the most part, we all get along. And so I kind of miss that. The Richmond Hill doesn't have that. If you go on their main business district, which is Jamaica Avenue, it's a little bit on the desolate side, which is another reason why I would like to try to help. I feel like there's a lot of room to grow Richmond Hill and want to see what we can do.
So as I get ready to wrap up, I'd love for you to let our listeners know where they can go if they'd like to learn more about QueensLink.
Sure. So if you go to our website, which is www.queenslink.org, there is a link. I'm just going to pull it up right now. So there's a little waffle in the corner. And then there is a link that says get involved. And if you click on get involved, then it's going to show you different ways you can connect with us through Facebook, through Twitter, Instagram. There's also a sign up for email blasts. Not too frequently, but we, you know, like to update you with where we stand. And, you know, you can give us your email and find out ways to get involved. We'd like to build a coalition of supporters as well. And also there's links to different elected officials if you'd like to let them know that you support our project.
And for our listeners, there's also some very good presentations that have been made before that you'll want to go through as well, that you can just absorb all the information regarding the project at that point. Paul Truss, thank you so much for appearing here today on the It's in Queens podcast.
Jeff, thank you so much for the opportunity. Really appreciate it.
Proponents of the plan point out that Queens has the highest population per mile of subway in the five boroughs, and that the borough needs transit equity to meet the needs of a growing population and new job markets, and that by strengthening public transit into boroughs outside of Manhattan to underserved neighborhoods, it'll save New Yorkers time and money. If you'd like to learn more about QueensLink, go to queenslink.org or send them an email at info@queenslink.org. You can also sign up for updates on the proposal. Onward. I was reading the New York Times spring preview section this past weekend and noting the Broadway and off-Broadway shows that are on the horizon. Alas, the section did not have much space to include everything, including many of the events that are going to be happening in Queens. Now, I know from conversations with several of our cultural venues here in the borough, there's a lot coming up to celebrate Women's History Month, programs at Flushing Town Hall, for instance, will do that. A Latin Jazz Festival at Queens Theater, and upcoming programming at the Museum of the Moving Image and MoMA PS1. So much more that I can't even go into everything here. But if you seek some guidance, you're looking for something to do, well, you need a Queens guru, someone who knows everything that's going on. That's Rob McKay. Each week, he shines a light on some of the fun, interesting, or unique events and activities in our borough. Here's this week's report.
Hello, Mr. Simmons. How are you? I'm just going to talk about two things, so that should be pretty brief, at least for me. The first thing is flamenco. Everybody loves flamenco. And the Talia Spanish Theater, which is located in Sunnyside, is going to present Mosaico Flamenco, which is a show that has all kinds of flamenco styles, from March 4th to March 20th. The shows are Fridays and Saturdays at 8 and Sundays at 4. If you liked flamenco, or if you like Spanish dancing, or if you just like the general emotionalness of it all, it's fantastic. And then the other thing I wanted to say is that the Free First Friday program is at Noguchi Museum. And that's to say that, true to its name, the first Friday of the month is free. And that happens to be March 4th. So from 11 o'clock on, you can go there for free and check it out. The only thing I have to say is that I put that in there because COVID is kind of loosening, or the COVID safety is loosening up, but still you have to schedule in advance for this because they try to space out their visitors due to COVID. So those are my two big things. Flamenco in Sunnyside and fantastic art, I should say Japan-influenced art in Long Island City. Thank you, Jeff, and hope to see you soon. And I hope everyone who consumes this program will be out in the borough this weekend. Thanks.
Thanks, Rob. Rob is with Queens Tourism Council and Queens Economic Development Corporation, which are behind this podcast. They promote Queens as a destination for business, for tourism, frankly, as a place for anyone who wants to live here, work here, or just visit. Now, you don't have to wait till next week's podcast to learn what else is on the horizon. Go to the It's in Queens website at itsinqueens.com. And you'll discover so much more. And if you want to know more about Queens, more news coming out of Queens, make sure to sign up for the Queens Economic Development Corporation's newsletter. You will get notified right in your inbox about upcoming events and other opportunities. So go to queensny.org and you could sign up. And don't forget, we cannot be everywhere. So when you're out and about in Queens, take a moment, snap some photos, and share images on Twitter and Instagram and tag us, or use the hashtag #ItsInQueens. Until next time, I'm your host, Jeff Simmons. So stay warm, stay safe, and stay dry. That's it for this week's It's in Queens podcast.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking.